Hello, we are the Association for Child and Adolescent Mental Health, or ACAM for short.
So, good morning everybody. I'm delighted to be here this morning. Thanks for the introduction, Basu. So yeah, I am Madeline Ardath. I'm a clinical psychologist by background. I split my time between a clinical post and working in a specialist 0-5s cancer service in central Manchester. We're fortunate, I guess, in central Manchester that we have some specialist funding to be able to think about early intervention, which I guess is my absolute passion, so I hope that will come across this morning. We've got a sort of 20-year history in terms of the Children and Parent Service, which is what the service is called, about providing evidence-based parenting interventions. And we were really lucky to be sort of listed in the NICE Guidance for Conduct Disorder as a best practice site for delivering parenting interventions in line with the NICE Guidance. So that's a sort of clinical role, and then in the other part of my working life, I spend 3 days a week leading for the Northwest CYPI Act programme in relation to parenting and also 0-5s. For those of you, just in terms of just a show of hands, is everyone familiar with what CYPI Act is, or do I just need to give a bit of an explanation? Yeah, pretty good. Okay, so for those of you who don't know what it is, it's a collaborative project between the Department of Health and Health Education England. It's about really trying to think about service transformation within CAMHS and being able to think about how we can ensure that we are skilling up and training the workforce in evidence-based interventions that they can deliver locally. So today, what I'm going to spend my time thinking about is, why parenting? And what we know from the evidence base, I guess, in terms of what works in terms of parenting intervention for conduct disorder. So in terms of, just to give you a bit of an overview, this is what I'm hoping to cover. So to just spend a little bit of time first thinking about why do we need to intervene? Why is this such an important area for us to be thinking about? And to think about the sort of cost of conduct disorder, not only in relation to the child and personal family, but also the sort of broad fiscal costs in terms of economic intervention. And then spend time thinking about, so why is parenting intervention so crucial in relation to this? I'm going to then focus on a specific parenting intervention called The Incredible Years. That's because it's the programme that we've got most experience of in Manchester. And also it was the parenting programme that was adopted by all 7 of the CYPI Act sites nationally. And I'll tell you a little bit about why that was at that time in terms of the evidence base. And I guess increasingly, I'm sure all of us in this room know just how tricky sort of achieving sustainable implementation of any evidence-based practice intervention is. And there's some useful literature that's beginning to emerge in terms of sustainable implementation in terms of evidence-based practice. I thought it might be helpful to spend some time towards the end of the presentation just thinking about what we know that sort of makes it work in the longer term, and how do we try and achieve sustainability in our services in terms of these models. Does that feel okay? Is that what people were sort of hoping for? Okay. So let's think about these costs then. So in terms of costs more broadly, I guess the most important place to start is, well, what are the costs to the child, young person, or family in relation to conduct disorder? So we know this top sort of aspect of this slide is to say conduct disorder remains the most common child and adolescent mental health problem. It's estimated at about 5.8% of the UK child population will go on to receive a diagnosis of conduct disorder. And I guess that this stat feels really important for me, that we're able to think about how we respond to this, not only within CAMHS, but also within community CAMHS settings. And I think that in relation to conduct disorder or broad behavioural, the severity of behavioural problems, unfortunately our services remain quite fragmented in terms of the support that we're able to offer to families. And I think the very fact it remains the most common mental health problem is that we do need to take some collective responsibility about how we intervene across agencies, as opposed to sort of compartmentalising and fragmenting our approach to parenting, to conduct disorder. And I guess the reason for that is unfortunately, the trajectory for children who have a diagnosis of conduct disorder is unfortunately an incredibly stark one. So 50% of children who get a diagnosis of conduct disorder will go on to develop antisocial personality disorder as adults. This is massive. And 70%, there's a 70-fold increase in being imprisoned by the age of 25 if you have a diagnosis of conduct disorder. So your life chances are significantly affected if you have this diagnosis in childhood. So the costs for the individual and the family system are very significant, and I guess something that just should be alarming to us in terms of the importance of us being able to ensure that we can intervene in ways that ensure effective intervention in relation to this. Okay, so I guess our services though at the moment, they don't just rely on effectiveness of intervention for the child or the family system, but increasingly we're being asked to provide evidence in terms of how are our services cost effective. And I guess in relation to conduct disorder, the economic argument is increasingly as strong as that in terms of intervention for the individual. So this is a study that was done by Scott et al. In 2001. It's a really helpful epidemiological study that was done in central London. So it was a helpfully UK-based sample. And what Scott looked at is what were the overall costs for an individual if you were age 10 or 28 and if you had no behavioural problems or if you had a diagnosis of conduct disorder. I'm just going to, yes, it's working, okay. So what I want you to just look at is this figure here. So what they found is that the total cost annually for children without a diagnosis of conduct disorder or behavioural problems was roughly about £7,500. And by the age of 28, for those individuals with conduct disorder, it was about 10 times higher, so it was about £70,000. So Edwards et al, he translated these prices, these sort of costs into sort of 2009, 2010 prices, so they're probably going to be even a bit more inflated now. But again, it was roughly sort of just under £10,000 per child without conduct disorder, or adult without conduct disorder, and then about £92,000 per 28-year-old with conduct disorder. So the costs are significant in terms of the services that children, young people, and then adults then go on to use who have a diagnosis of conduct disorder. And what Scott found was that these costs were spread across services, but the most significant cost was in relation to crime. So nearly £45,000 was attributed to crime spending given an early diagnosis of conduct disorder. But what we also saw is that these children and young people actually used a broad range of services, tended to be more heavily users of social care and often needed specialist educational provision. So these costs also then were increased sort of within these sectors. Okay, so I guess this is about us thinking about costs that span across sectors, which again, I guess, makes this specific mental health problem one that does need a multi-agency approach. So Sainsbury's Centre for Mental Health in 2009, they thought that about 80% of overall crime spending was attributed to people who had had a diagnosis of conduct disorder in childhood, which related to about nearly £50 billion in terms of crime spending. And finally, so just in terms of what these sort of costs are trajectories in terms of the lifespan, Fridelli and Parsonage in 2007 looked at a cohort of young people with conduct disorder, and they sort of tracked the annual sort of costs in terms of that cohort over a lifespan, and they estimated that it was probably about a £5.2 billion cost for an annual cohort over a lifetime of children with conduct disorders. So this is a costly disorder, not only sort of fiscally in terms of economically to society, but also significantly for children, young people, families and communities sort of experiencing these difficulties. Okay, so why parenting then? So why parenting in the sort of grand scheme in terms of how we ensure effective intervention? So I guess it will come as no surprise to you that conduct disorder has a multifaceted a range of risk factors. So if we start with child factors, actually children with conduct disorder often have poor conflict control, impulsivity, and there's a high comorbidity with ADHD. Often children with learning delays or poor social skills. And those factors sort of directly impact on their ability to access educational environments. So they're often children who display high levels of childhood aggression. They're seen as sort of deviant by peers, and actually often experience really significant sort of peer and social relationship difficulties. And often in relation to teaching, it's often seen as sort of narratives around a naughty child or a difficult child that can't be managed within particular settings. Contextually, they're children who often have a really tricky start. They're children who have a number of contextual risk factors. So children who are more likely to be growing up in poverty, have parental crime, substance abuse or mental illness within that background, and have significant life stresses from early on in childhood. And there was an interesting study done by Howarth in 2004 that suggested that for about 40% of children who experienced domestic abuse, they were in the clinical range for behavioural concerns, as opposed to only about 10% who hadn't. So it shows that domestic abuse is also a significant contextual factor within the sort of systemic nature of the risk factors for conduct disorder. It's probably no surprise, really, but it also shows the sort of significance of the importance of comprehensive holistic assessments when we're thinking about assessing conduct disorder and then thinking about intervention. And then finally, so the bit that I'm going to spend most of my time talking about, we know that there are a number of parental risk factors that are more likely to be correlated with a diagnosis of conduct disorder. So within these families, often parenting is seen as harsh and ineffective. There's often problems in terms of consistent limit setting. It's often seen to be poor monitoring, so supervision, and low stimulation in terms of one-to-one attention or stimulation of sort of educational activities. And I guess in terms of the argument for parenting, it's this one that actually out of them all is probably the most effective in terms of change, but it's also the easiest to intervene at. It's actually quite difficult at times. We would love to be able to reduce these things, but contextual risk factors, particularly if there's a suite of them, actually it's very difficult for us to be able to intervene. And some of these intrinsic difficulties might also make intervention in relation to the child level relatively difficult. So if we can intervene here, we potentially then break these cycles in terms of the trajectory, in terms of parent and conduct disorders moving forward. So I guess that's the rationale sort of theoretically in terms of parent training. But again, I just want to spend some time thinking about economically what's this argument, and also from the evidence base, what does the evidence base say in terms of effectiveness of parenting intervention? So really usefully, in recent years, there's been a number of sort of significant UK RCTs that have been done in relation to parenting intervention for conduct disorder. I'm going to talk about those in a moment. And increasingly, the research trend is that they, in large-scale studies, also need to provide a cost-benefit analysis. So we can determine not only is this intervention effective in terms of clinical outcome, but also that it will provide cost savings in the longer term, sort of societally. So I just wanted to share some stats in relation to that. So on this box was a study done by the Centre for Mental Health. And they looked at sort of emerging conduct disorder, so children who had a diagnosis of, or had a severity in terms of behavioural problems, perhaps pre a conduct disorder diagnosis being given. And they found, in relation to those children, the estimated lifelong costs were obviously lower than if a diagnosis had been given, at about £260,000 per child. And actually the cost of intervention significantly was significantly less than that. So the cost benefit of that those programmes was significant, costing about £1,300 on average per child in terms of a parent who was accessing a parenting intervention. So I guess significant cost savings over a lifetime in terms of that. And as the RCTs have become more sophisticated in terms of looking at cost benefit analysis, we've been able to see even more sort of sophisticated analysis of cost-benefit savings in relation to interventions. So Edwards et al. In 2006, they looked at the cost-benefit analysis of a large-scale Wales RCT that was done, which I'm going to talk about in a moment. And what basically this sort of complicated graph is showing is that if a society were prepared to pay roughly up to £2,500 per child for a parenting intervention, we've got about an 82% probability that we'll get savings back in terms of that expenditure. So again, that we're not only increasingly being able to have sort of RCTs that are supporting the importance of intervening, but also that there's long-term cost savings in relation to that. Okay, so I'm sure many of you are aware of the NICE guidance in relation to conduct disorder. They're updated in 2013. And they're really clear, actually, in terms of what we should be offering. Alongside the 2013 NICE guidance was a large meta-analysis done in terms of the evidence base to try and support NICE to be able to make some clear recommendations in terms of what was effective. And like I say, they do give really clear guidance towards the service providers in terms of what we should be providing. And that is, generally, group-based parent training programmes for parents of children and young people between the ages of 3 and 11. And that is for those children who are identified as high risk for conduct disorder or oppositional defiance disorder, they have a diagnosis of ODD or conduct disorder, or for any young person who has been in contact with the juvenile justice system in terms of antisocial behaviour. And they're very clear that actually the evidence bases in relation to group-based parent training as opposed to individual-based parent training. And there's some exceptions in the NICE guidance for that. So it says where possible this should be indicated. You know, where severe parental anxiety might prevent parents from accessing a programme, then a one-to-one intervention should be offered. But as the norm, the standard intervention should be group-based parenting interventions, because the evidence base is so much greater when offered in that format. And again, usefully, it tells us what those programmes should look like. There's been lots of research done in terms of the components of those programmes that make them effective. So generally, they should typically be have between 10 and 12 parents in the group. Groups of less than that tend to not have the same level of group process or peer support or effectiveness. And any more than 12 parents, often that group process becomes more difficult to manage in terms of being able to tailor the programme to individual families' needs. The parenting programmes that are effective tend to be based on a social learning model. They need to include modelling, so video modelling or facilitator-based modelling, rehearsal, so the ability to practice and support parents to be able to practice skills before they go back to their home environment to try them out, and also to be given the opportunity to then provide feedback on how going away and trying some of these things have worked. So all of these components feel really significant in ensuring that the programme of choice has these elements. Typically, they consist of 10 to 16 meetings of about 90 to 120 minutes duration. And I guess this one is increasingly an important one. They need to adhere to the developer's manual, or basically they need to have model fidelity. So we need to be ensuring that as services we're supporting our practitioners to be able to deliver interventions in the way that the evidence suggests is effective. So just on an aside to this, so I guess one of the things that I guess I'm asked probably at least once a month is, well, Maddie, that's all well and good, but it's really tricky to deliver group-based parenting in CAMHS. It would just be much more easy to do it as a one-to-one, because that fits sort of our service structure and we're really feeling pressured right now. I hear, could we make it slightly less sessions, because actually it doesn't fit into the school half-term, and it just means it's a bit tricky in terms of being able to ensure that we get parents to complete this intervention. And I guess, so in response to those, so I absolutely appreciate the very real-time pressures in terms of CAMHS environments currently. But just as an aside to illustrate this point, I thought it might be helpful for us to briefly look at the NICE guidance for type 1 diabetes for children. So I just want you to bear with me for this bit. Okay. So I'm not a medic by background, so I've only briefly put these points, but roughly, from my reading of the NICE guidance for type 1 diabetes, there's four main elements that are important. The first one is to provide education and information. The second one is to provide insulin therapy. There's very specific recommendations in relation to that. So they need to be either injections of short-acting insulin with every meal, together with one or more separate injections of intermittent-acting insulin, or that the child will be on insulin pump therapy. Needs to be the provision of dietary and exercise management that should be given to the whole family and not just the child. And there should be blood glucose monitoring for a minimum of 5 times a day. So I want us to just hold in mind, if we as service providers or commissioners in relation to diabetes, what our thoughts would be if we said, okay, so the recommendation is that we provide injections every meal, but, you know, could we just do that for one meal a day? And rather than providing blood glucose monitoring 5 times a day, could we just do it like once a week? Because it's quite costly and it's quite invasive in terms of this child's and parents' sort of quality of life. And actually, it's really tricky to do exercise and dietary management with the family system. So could we not just do it with the child? And I think every single one of us in this room would go, absolutely no way, because it means that the treatment won't be effective. And I guess that's a really important question that we need to think about when we're looking and determining the NICE guidance for any child and adolescent mental health difficulty or disorder, is that not only just in relation to conduct disorder, but the minute we start tweaking any elements of what the NICE guidance is saying in order to try and ensure that we can make it fit within our sometimes quite stretched services, actually we increasingly lose the effectiveness of that intervention. So the decisions that we need to make in terms of delivery of evidence-based interventions is really important, because often a small amount of investment at that stage will ensure effectiveness in the longer term, which is what we're trying to achieve, particularly given the poor trajectory in terms of conduct disorder. Okay. I've just included this slide just for information again, I'm sure you know, but in terms of the preschool children particularly, and then for school-age children with moderate ADHD, group-based parenting interventions are also the recommended treatment of choice. So that's important for us to consider, because there is this high comorbidity in terms of ADHD and conduct disorder, but it's actually the same intervention that's often indicated for both of these difficulties. Okay, so I'm going to spend the rest of my time thinking about the Incredible Years specifically. Hopefully that provides a bit of an overview of the broad rationale for parenting. But like I said, the model that sort of, I guess, in the Northwest we have most experience with is in relation to the Incredible Years. It's absolutely not the only model that fulfills the requirements in terms of effective parenting intervention. And to just summarise what they are, So the, again, this meta-analysis that was linked to sort of the NICE guidance in terms of what makes programs effective suggested that they needed to have these components. So new parenting skills or behaviour management strategies needed to be able to be modelled and rehearsed. So that basically means role practice, which again, for practitioners, is a really tricky thing to do. And I often, again, will hear from services or from clinicians saying, yep, we absolutely do the incredible years, but parents don't like role play, and I don't like facilitating role play, so we just don't do that component of it. So it's really important that we think about our training and support for practitioners to be able to ensure that they deliver programmes with the elements that we know make them effective for parents. They need to have a component in which the majority of intervention is happening outside of the session. So for all clinically effective parenting programmes, there's generally home tasks that are set. Parents go away and do sort of be able to do those strategies at home with their child in their unique home situations, and then importantly they then come back to the group and provide feedback in relation to how that's been going, or are able to be supported to be able to implement those strategies in a way that feels helpful for them. That all of these programmes that were effective, actually was a really key aspect was that this wasn't about practitioners standing at the front and telling parents what to do. It was ensuring that practitioners were able to fully collaborate with parents. That for a parent accessing any sort of parenting intervention, their likelihood is that they're coming into that group feeling unsure, overwhelmed, blamed, or criticised. So these groups need to be as partners with parents, empowering them to be able to make decisions about their own parenting and what they do in terms of supporting their child, as opposed to being told what is the best for their child. And again, that's therefore really important that we're supporting clinicians to be able to develop appropriate skills in collaboration, and that it's not just the content of these programmes that feel important, but equitably the process and ensuring that parents are sort of equal collaborative partners. All effective programmes had non-violent sanctions for negative behaviour. So in relation to the incredible years, that's in relation to effective limit setting, timeout, and consequences. I'm really sorry, I've got a frog in my throat, someone just fell off, thank you. This element is really important because what we see in terms of the characteristics of children with conduct disorder is that increasingly there's coercive cycles that often occur in families. So as child behaviour becomes increasingly aggressive, violent or non-compliant, parents feel forced into providing increasingly aggressive or punitive ways of responding. And that leads to dangerous situations because aggression and abuse of parenting then tends to increase. So we need to be able to ensure that we can give parents an alternative. From my experience with working with parents, generally they don't want to be smacking their children or engaging in punitive discipline, but they talk about feeling like they have no alternative, that they feel completely out of control and don't know what to do. So ensuring that they not only have support and intervention to ensure that they can increase positive attention and their attachment and their relationship with their child, but also to be supported to ensure they're able to follow through with consistent and effective and yet safe limit setting is an important aspect of all effective programmes. And most of these programmes also address difficulties in adult relationships or family relationships. And again, that feels quite significant if we go back to thinking that probably about 40% of these families, in Manchester it's way higher, are percentage of families who are accessing the group who've got a history or current domestic abuse is incredibly high, about 70 or 80%. that actually we need to ensure that we're supporting parents to sort of think about how to safely manage some of the contextual problems that they might be experiencing. So in relation to these components, the Incredible Years fulfills all of these criteria, but other programmes do too, so Triple P, the Oregon Parenting Programme, and Strengthening Families and Strengthening Communities all have these elements. So I'm going to talk about Incredible Years today, but I'm not saying that, you know, that's the only intervention of choice, but I am going to present some research which is why that was chosen as the intervention of choice for the CYPIAP sites across the country. So like I said, really, really helpfully, so for a long time we've been trying to extrapolate sort of generally US data and applying it to our UK populations, which never feels ideal really, in terms of making decisions about what are the best interventions and service decisions for the communities that we're all working in. And since the sort of 2010 onwards, there's been an increasingly activity in terms of UK-based RCTs, which have been done to a very high quality that have given us some very interesting sort of data in terms of making some of these decisions. So one of these was commissioned by Birmingham City Council. So what they wanted to do as part of their Brighter Future initiatives is determine how they were going to spend and invest in a particular early intervention parenting strategy. But they were saying, we don't know which one to use. We want to ensure that we're using this money in a cost-effective way. So they commissioned an RCT to compare three different parenting interventions. And they were the Incredible Years, Triple P, and PATHS, which is a school-based intervention as opposed to a home-based intervention. And though RCTs, so children were selected who were at high risk of conduct disorder, so 3- and 4-year-olds, and they were randomised to those different treatment interventions and then comparison done accordingly. And what they found is that the Incredible Years yielded reductions in negative parenting behaviour among parents, reductions in child behavioural problems, and improvements in child relationships. And importantly, those improvements were sustained over time. And I'm going to, again, show you some data in a minute in relation to the importance of us considering follow-up in terms of these studies. In the PATHS trial, so the intervention that was delivered through schools, there were modest improvements in emotional health and behavioural development. But unfortunately, so that was seen at 1-year follow-up, but unfortunately those effects have disappeared by year two. So again, they're really important in terms of our design of RCTs, of where possible, trying to ensure that we include a follow-up to see actually are these interventions effective and sustained over time. And unfortunately for Triple P within this study, there was no effect, there was no significant effect at post or at follow-up. So there was sort of a significant question mark in relation to how this was fitting with this sort of population. So based on this study, and the cost effectiveness study that happened alongside it, Birmingham decided that they were going to commission Incredible Years for all high-risk 3- and 4-year-olds across the city. So there was a systematic rollout and training in terms of their staff in order to try and ensure that they were intervening early in terms of prevention of conduct disorder within the city. And so just linked to that, there's been two other UK RCTs which have provided us with similar evidence. The first one of that was the Welsh All Star trial. It was led by Bangor University and there's quite a dominant researcher called Judy Hutchins there. And they looked again at sort of high risk children for developing conduct disorder, sort of 3- and 4-year-olds. And they delivered this large scale RCT across Wales. And then in a separate but similar related RCT, Ireland decided that they wanted to do a national evaluation of the Incredible Years. They looked at children that were slightly older, so 5- to 8-year-olds, but they were specifically interested in looking at children from disadvantaged areas. Again, when you think about the correlations in terms of social, economic disadvantage and poverty and conduct disorder, it felt like a really important population to be thinking about. So just to share the sort of combined results in relation to those. So they looked at child behaviour. So what was the impact of the incredible years in relation to child behaviour? So this black line here is the clinical cutoff for behavioural disorder or behavioural concerns as shown by the IBIRG. So for those of you who don't know the IBIRG, it's just a routine outcome measure that's generally quite sensitive in terms of behavioural difficulties because it looks at not just both frequency but also management. So it's often used as a more sensitive measure to the SDQ. And they found, sort of non-surprisingly, that the mean score for children was that they were in the clinical range on the IBIRG for behavioural problems pre-intervention. Post-intervention, this is a really interesting finding. So for both the Wales and Ireland study, post-intervention, these children have fallen from clinical to non-clinical ranges. So there was an absolute sort of clinical significance in terms of taking children out of the risk factor for behavioural problems. And most importantly, these changes were then sustained over time. So at 12 and 18 months, it was still in non-clinical ranges on the IBIRG. In terms of parental depression, that was also looked at because there's high correlation between conduct disorder in children and parental depression in adults. And that's probably a two-way process. We know that the risk factors for conduct disorder include parental mental health difficulties, but also managing a child with conduct disorder is likely to be incredibly stressful. So actually increase prevalence in terms of depression is very frequent when intervening in terms of these families. Again, this black line is an indication of the clinical cutoff for mild depression, as shown by the BDI, so the VET depression inventory. And again, pre-intervention for both groups, the mean was in the clinical range. So the parents were generally scoring in the clinical range for depression pre-intervention. Post-intervention, at 6 months, again, parents had gone into the non-clinical range. So actually a child behavioural parenting intervention had actually shown significant improvements in parental mental health, which again just shows the significance in terms of multi-agency thinking. This is a multi-agency benefit in terms of our successful intervention strategy around this. And again, that this was shown to be sustained at 12 months and 18 month follow-up. So parental mental health was also then sustained over time. Just some, I guess, like we say, in terms of increasingly, there's a body of literature around implementation science, which is basically about how do we do this then? So it's incredibly difficult to implement evidence-based intervention in a sustainable way. I know that in relation to my experience in relation to CYPI Act, that it's a whole systemic approach in terms of thinking about how we embed evidence-based practice organisationally within particular settings. And that's by no means easy. There's all sorts of organisational barriers that make that incredibly challenging. And this sort of increased area of research, which was looking at this implementation science, sort of can help us to provide some answers in terms of what we should be thinking about when developing services in relation to parenting for conduct disorder, and that we don't just do things in an ad hoc way, but we think about how we would want to pilot those, ensure effectiveness, and then hopefully try and achieve sustainability over time. So what does this literature say who it works for? So it says that social disadvantage did not predict poorer outcome for the incredible years or for parenting intervention more broadly. And that's really significant finding because, like what we talked about, conduct disorder has got a much higher prevalence in social economic disadvantage. So it's really important to see that actually those changes were still seen across the communities in which we're working in. It was shown that for boys particularly and younger children and for parents who tended to have higher levels of depression, the programme was more effective. So again, that it shouldn't be therefore that parental mental health as an indicator is something that we say that this doesn't warrant intervention or that it warrants individual intervention. actually the very fact of parental mental health being involved or in the mix in terms of some of those contextual risk factors was actually a positive indicator of successful outcome. Whereas in contrast, interventions for serious antisocial behaviour in adolescents tended to be much less effective. So the sort of evidence is that the earlier we are able to intervene in relation to conduct disorder, the likelihood of a better outcome in the longer term. Again, it's sort of, it's not rocket science, but the research backs up our thinking in relation to that. So just linked to that, this is a slide from The Incredible Years, but it's an interesting one, because if we look at this top black line, these are children with high levels of aggression. So actually the children who are aggressive toddlers, who are then likely to become aggressive adolescents or adults, it shows that this trajectory remains quite fixed over time. So actually, our ability to be able to intervene in relation to conduct problems has definitely got a window of effectiveness. If we don't intervene at that time, it tends to then be a fixed pattern that's sustained throughout sort of older adulthood, adolescence, and then into later life. Again, that's not rocket science. We know, we heard from them at the beginning of this presentation about some of the unfortunate trajectory statistics in relation to criminal behaviour, in relation to the correlates between conduct disorder in childhood and later criminal activity. So it's no surprise that it suggests that we need to be intervening earlier and providing early intervention of under fives in order for us to ensure prevention as well as treatment of conduct disorder. I just thought I would include this slide because it's one of my favourites working in early intervention, and I guess makes me as passionate about this area as I am. It's just a nice illustration of this really, again, in terms of our spending of some of these difficulties over time. So we know this pink line is our brain's capacity for change. So we know by the age of 3, the brain has developed to about 90% of its adult capacity, and the majority of that brain development is in year 1. So as the brain becomes increasingly myelinated and sort of neural network pruning has happened, it then becomes less likely and more rigid to change. That's why I guess we should definitely learn foreign languages in early childhood, because it becomes increasingly difficult to do it in older childhood and later childhood. I think this graph is slightly flawed. There probably should be a peak here in terms of adolescence where the brain goes through a lovely sort of reorganisation, and also is this lovely opportunity in terms of therapeutic change at that time. But actually, it's still quite frank and stark that actually brain development and flexibility of intervention for change is much more likely before the age of 3. And if we contrast this to the black line, this is public spending in relation to intervention. And what we see is that actually our 0-5 services, so the services that potentially ensure the biggest capacity for change, have the lowest public spending. And as we go on into adolescence and then older adulthood, actually our spending significantly increases, but actually at a time where change may be just much more difficult in relation to thinking about capacity to change. I'm absolutely not saying that it's all hopeless and we can't change or intervene in later adolescence or adulthood. I guess what I'm saying is that we need to think again about a lifespan perspective in terms of thinking about conduct disorder, that we're not only thinking about treatment and intervention when problems become really significant for societally or across services, which potentially might be adolescence or adulthood, but we're also able to take a preventative approach in terms of early childhood. The other thing about implementation science is that it's told us a little bit about effectiveness of intervention depending on facilitator training and skill. And what Scott et al. In 2008 found was that therapist skill had a major influence on parent training and group outcome. And that was even when a whole load of other variables were controlled for. So things like hyperactivity, child age, aspects of the therapeutic process or therapeutic relationship, and the ability to sort of control for those factors, is important because it suggests that we really need to ensure that we invest in appropriate training and ongoing model-specific supervision to ensure that we can provide facilitators with appropriate training to be able to deliver interventions that are in line with that how it's done in the research, which suggests is how we get effective interventions. And again, I think that's an interesting thing for us to think about because increasingly it seems like parenting is being sort of moved out of camps and is increasingly moving into voluntary or independent sector organisations, which is a helpful, this is definitely a community camps problem. We need to be able to think about families accessing support in accessible ways, but we therefore need to ensure that whoever is providing those interventions has been and is supported appropriately to be able to deliver them in line with model fidelity, I guess. Okay, so what are the key lessons learned from this implementation literature? So it's that we should know what outcomes and change is required. Do we want to lead to significant clinical reductions in behaviour problems? Do we want to improve mental health? Do we not want to reduce antisocial behaviour? We then need to select an evidence-based programme that's suited to that target population and that properly fulfils those criteria of effective programmes that we've talked about before. We need to develop a strategy for targeting families. So if thinking about early intervention, we need to be able to have a strategy in terms of how we identify those children that are at higher risk of developing conduct disorder and address sort of relevant service access issues. So in Manchester, we deliver all our programmes within children's centres just because it ensures that parents are able to deliver intervention at a location that is convenient and local to them and that often they're able to sort of have some familiarity with. We need to ensure staff training and ongoing support, and like I said, that needs to be through specialist training and ongoing model specific supervision. And I guess we need to factor that into how we ensure the ongoing nature of that within service transformation. And we need to ensure implementation fidelity. This is just, I'm not going to go through this, but The Incredible Years provides a bit of guidance in terms of service developers or commissioners in terms of what things they might need to consider in terms of thinking about sustainable implementation over time. And it's interesting because most groups fail actually at this logistic level. They don't have the correct materials, they can't access a room, they can't be able to sort of access funding to have a fresh facility, and therefore it just fails. And actually investment here, again, small amount of investment here, often does lead to successful implementation of programmes. In addition to this next level, which is the type of practitioners that we're training, so selection of practitioners who want to do this work and who are skilled at it, and then appropriate training and support so they can do it with model fidelity. I'm not going to go through this, but in relation to CYPI Act, I guess that's the reason why we are doing what we are at the moment, that CYPI Act in relation to parent training means that professionals from both CAMHS, voluntary, social care and independent services can access high quality training and most significantly really intensive model specific supervision over that year period. So actually that their sort of skill and competency development is sort of exponential over that year in terms of them being able to provide effective intervention. So I guess my closing message in relation to conduct disorder is that we probably have to speculate to accumulate, that we need to be able to think about intervention as well as reactive management of conduct disorder, so prevention as well as intervention in later life. And I guess given the broad-ranging systemic outcomes in terms of conduct disorder, I wonder whether we increasingly need to be thinking about a multi-agency approach to intervention in terms of conduct disorder, in terms of health, education, and crime, as opposed to some of that feeling like it just sits within health. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Questions. I hope you don't have lots. Okay, one, two.
Hi, I'm Sherman and Rana of the Business of the Psychiatrist. Thank you very much for a really, really, I think, informative keynote lecture. I think you made a very good point with that video, and I was really struck by the fact how that mother was sort of really motivated but also appreciated the improvement in the school attendance. And I've just got your final sentence almost resonated with me again to think about. So, yeah, so we have evidence that we can do this and we can do this well, and if we have impact, we can do it at the right time and enough of it. However, where should we do it? How should we do it? Who should we do it with? Because that partnership with somewhere like education or social care and where it is delivered and nearby, and that motivation can actually make all the difference. You know, keeping it in counter mix, it doesn't make sense to me at all.
It absolutely,
I just wanted your thoughts on that.
Yeah, no, I completely agree that. So in Manchester, CAPS Works is a multi-agency organisation. So as clinical psychologists, we sit within health. We do provide, we still deliver interventions, but our main role is to ensure model-specific supervision and support and sustainable implementation of programmes over time. And then our parent group leaders who deliver those programmes sit within the local authority, Barnardo's, Action for Children and Big Life, so in charitable and independent organisations. And we deliver them in community settings, so children's centres, but we, our links with schools are significant. And in relation to CYPI Act pilot partners as well, we've got increasingly school staff who train in relation to CYPI Act so they can deliver in school-based settings. So I agree, I don't think it's a perfect fit for all, but the more they can be community-based, multi-agency, sort of programmes, the better. And I guess that that might be that delivery, say, sits with education, but CAMS remains a partner in terms of support for model fidelity or supervision. So I think increasingly us being creative about our arrangements in relation to that feels significant.
Because that's like tangible benefits, like improved school attendance or housing or whatever.
Definitely. In relation to that, so because of the GM transformation, Andy Burnham's main one of his key indicators is school readiness at the moment. So he's really interested in terms of thinking about parenting intervention early on in relation to school readiness. So actually I think we'll increasingly see more of a shift across Greater Manchester in relation to intervention occurring within school settings.
I've got three very good things.
Okay, I'll do
a
mindful.
Number one, in the outcomes that we're looking at, the one outcome I was looking for was educational outcomes.
Yes.
Particularly reduction of special education needs, etc. The second one is really comes out of what the other said. I mean, the putting it in the children's centre has been a really good idea.
Yeah.
Multidisciplinary, by definition.
Yes.
Of course, they're being cut.
And,
so my next question is, you know, what is the next thing that you're going to do in terms of, you know, embedding it within the community in a multidisciplinary setting? Because a school is not necessarily multidisciplinary. And the final one is, what about as research changes? You were talking about the 2008 ADHD stuff, which has just been modified quite considerably last month. You know, what about the modifications to the program in order to try and keep it close to the principles and then the follow-on research to show it's still valid?
So I agree with all your points. I think decimation of Sure Start has been a significant thing for us as a service because we're a 0-5 service. And I think it is, you're absolutely right, I think I agree that there's something about how do we dynamically evolve and adapt to ensure that we fit with our current community settings, but also that we remain on top of the research and adapt intervention accordingly. There's some really interesting new parenting interventions. It's something called the EPET study that's been done by the Parent-Child Centre in London, and they've got a number of pilot sites, one of which is in Blackpool, I think, in the northwest. And that programme has different components to the ones that previously have been found to be effective. So they're much more parent-led and parental empowering. And they're sort of emerging RCTs in terms of that literature is increasingly promising. So I think we do absolutely need to ensure that we keep track of developments to ensure that, yeah, we don't just deliver out the same stuff. And I guess linked to that is that we don't just look at the broad evidence base, but we really ensure that we're able to capture locally
our outcomes. So in Manchester, we continue to use the BDI, the Iberg and the PSI for all our parents pre and post intervention. And at the moment, we find a similar outcomes in terms of the RCT, so from clinical to non-clinical. The minute that starts to change, we need to do something about it. But in order to do that, we need effective routine outcome monitoring to help make sensible decisions. But yeah, thank you for your points, because I think they're all really relevant.
To be part of the advancement of child and adolescent mental health, visit www.acamh.org.